in the hood, in the trenches, a lot of people are trying to tell you, start getting money. Oh, you need to invest in real estate. You need to go buy homes. You need to go buy property. You need to go do this. You need to go do that. I hate that mentality because it's like, bro, you don't understand anything about the real estate market at all. You feel me? So how are you going to tell me what I should or shouldn't do? What's good, YouTube? It's your boy Campbell, and we're back with another video. Now, if this is your first time clicking on my channel, I want to say, first and foremost, welcome to the trenches. Do me a favor. Hit that subscribe button as well as turning on that notification bell. That way you're notified anytime that I drop some content. While you're at it, please leave a like down below. It helps the algorithm, it helps my channel continue to grow, and helps push my content out in front of more and more people. And if this isn't your first time clicking on my videos, I want to say welcome back to the trenches, man. I appreciate y'all, man. It's your boy Meech reporting live from the trenches, and I got some good content for y'all today. And before we get deep into the video, I just want to say, please do me a favor. Follow me on my social medias. Follow me on my Instagram, follow me on my Twitter, and follow me on my Snapchat. That way you can stay up to date and in the loop with everything I got going on in my personal life, outside of finance, YouTube, and business. Now, with the real estate market experiencing surging prices and a backlog of new home construction, many consumers are left wondering if what comes up will eventually come back down. In other words, are we headed for another market crash, or are things going to stabilize and eventually pan out? Today, we're going to take a closer look at the real estate market, and we're going to see, is it even worth investing and getting into in 2021 if you're not already in the business? We're not only going to discuss if it's even worth getting in, but we're also going to talk about the pros, the cons, and we're going to talk about the most effective and efficient way to get in. Now, I'm pretty sure that not many people saw the housing market crash that occurred about 15 years ago. That pretty much ignited the whole world in recession, fueled by low interest rates, loose mortgage lending standards, and the nation's unshakable faith in home ownership. Home values rose at a record rate year after year. When the housing bubble burst, about 9 million families lost their homes due to foreclosures or short sales between 2006 and 2014. Housing values plunged 30% or more. Homeowners lost a collective $2 trillion. I don't think I understand that, $2 trillion. And it took nearly a decade for most markets to recover. Even today, several local real estate markets have not fully recovered. Today's mini boom cannot be anywhere near considered the same as what happened 15 years ago during the recession, but I think it's something we can kind of compare and look at, because due to the pandemic, we've seen the housing market go up, we've seen it go down, and I think this is a collective trend. We're trying to figure out if and when is the best and safest time to invest and look into real estate and how you should go about doing so. Now, the first thing we have to consider is higher lending standards. Loose mortgage lending practices ultimately brought down some of the nation's largest banks and mortgage companies. The fallout forced Congress and federal regulators to make significant adjustments that have since fundamentally changed how mortgage lending is regulated. Since then, standards have been raised and the process of obtaining a mortgage is now more transparent. Anyone can get one. Types of loans are now illegal. While borrowers must undergo rigorous income and asset checks, an entirely new regulatory agency, the Consumer Finance Protection Bureau, was created to enforce this new regulatory framework. Lenders who do not comply with these standards risk severe penalties. As a result, the housing finance marketplace is now more robust and is safer than it was 15 years ago. Any dip in the housing market will be cushioned by these stricter regulations. And what all that pretty much means is that a lot of lenders were not being transparent in the way that they were advertising and bringing forth applications. They're pretty much telling people that anyone can get approved despite your credit and things like that. And that's simply not true. We all know that. We've been talking about it on this channel now for the last few months. It takes credit, it takes income, it takes a collection of different things. It takes a lot to actually get approved for things. And I'm just realizing what it takes to get a car. I can only imagine work it takes to get approved for a home to get into the real estate business. And I think this is gonna help protect people moving forward, because I think 15 years ago, I think people weren't as transparent. They're just kind of letting anybody get homes, or pretty much trying to tell people that anybody can get a home and anybody can get approved. And that's simply just not true. If you don't have the income nor the credit history, how or why would they possibly approve it? You know what I'm saying? It makes no sense for a lender to even put the information out there. So now that people are more transparent, more straightforward, more honest, I believe it allows people to not be fooled or deceived and not put themselves in bad situations where you have people losing their homes. The second thing we have to consider is the pandemic mortgages forbearing. When the housing market crashed in 2007, the influx of foreclosure pumped housing supply into areas with falling prices, weak labor markets, while also preventing recently foreclosed borrowers from re-entering the market for years. According to the Federal Reserve, foreclosures during a time of high unemployment could depress prices, plunging homeowners across the country into deeper negative equity. However, during this pandemic era, the effects of mass unemployment bear little resemblance of the Great Recession. Thanks in large part to forbearance programs that allowed homeowners to postpone their monthly mortgage payments without suffering as many penalties. As of early as March 2021, 2.6 million homeowners' mortgages were on such a forbearance plan. As the pandemic economy has slowly recovered, many homeowners have since resumed their employment and thus their payments. According to the CoreLogic, by the end of 2020, overall mortgage delinquencies declined 5.8% due to the forbearance program. The share of mortgages 60 to 89 days past due declined as 0.5%, lower than 0.6% in December 2019. It's worth noting, however, that serious delinquencies defined as 90 days or more past due, including loans and foreclosure, increased when owners who owned a large amount of left forbearance. By the end of the year in 2020, the serious delinquency rate was 3.9%, up from 1.2% in December 2019. Inevitably, some owners in the forbearance will fail to secure a loan modification or a lengthy repayment period from the lenders. Unless the government provides a bailout for the owners, they will lose their homes when forbearance ends. And to summarize some of that, pretty much what I was stating was that the way we've gone about things in the pandemic era has helped. It has helped keep people in their homes and has helped people negotiate and come together with a plan to make payments on the property so that they won't be put out even after they can't afford it, maybe due to unemployment or something due to the pandemic. But the negative side is there are also a lot of consequences that came from this as well. So it's a double-edged sword. It's one of those things, it's good, but it's also bad. Granted, nothing in life is all good. The third thing that we must consider is a cushion of homeowners' equity. Equity is the difference between the current market value of your home and the amount you owe on it. In other words, it's a portion of your home's value that you actually own. Equity can be incentive to stay in your home longer. If prices rise, something we've seen almost universally across the country in recent homes, your equity increases too. Well, you might be asking, why does this matter? Simply put, higher levels of equity cushion homeowners from defaulting on their loan. Over the past decade, American homeowners have enjoyed housing stability and grown, building up large homes and equity reserves. In the third quarter of 2020, the average family with mortgages had $194,000 in home equity, and the average homeowner gained approximately $26,000 in equity over the course of the year. In contrast, 2009 saw nearly a quarter of the nation's mortgage home valued for less than the amount of their homeowners actually owed on the properties. To summarize, this is pretty much stating like the home equity and the value of your home compared to the market. And what just to do, a lot of people saw the prices of homes rise and inflate. And like I said earlier in the video, it's a slippery slope. We see times where it goes up and we see times where it goes severely down. And you have people wanting to cash out and to maximize on that potential. As stated, due to the numbers, it might be best to kind of hold on to your home, wait it out, and sit and see what happens. Therefore, if your home value falls, you have that equity, that homeowner's equity cushion that kind of helps you and keeps you from defaulting on your loan or whatever when the value of your homes and the prices of your home falls. And the fourth thing we must consider is growth may slow down, but it will never actually stop. The sales boom following the outbreak and the start of the pandemic in April 2020 surprised many real estate. Like most other business sectors, real estate was also expected, if not required, in many locations to lock down. But by mid-April, sales were soaring as buyers, many of the millennials, took advantage of the record low mortgage interest, and existing home sales reached their highest level in 14 years. The combination of both solid sales and depleted values drove the nation's median existing home price for all housing types to $309,800, which is 12.9% up from December 2019, and marking 106 straight months of year-over-year gain. The multi-year run of significant price increases will end, at least temporarily, but inflationary pressure on entry-level homes will continue in most markets. While there is no expert to fully be able to say, hey, the market's gonna do this, it's gonna do that, or this is what you should do, or this is what you shouldn't do. Just like the market rises, eventually it's gonna dip, but it's still a call to kind of stay involved and stay in the loop of market trends. Is real estate the way to go in 2021? I think it depends on who you are. I think it depends on where you are financially, where you are mentally, and what you're hoping to achieve and what you're hoping to accomplish. It's one of those things where it's not as black as white. We can just answer is one way better than the other. What I can say is that if you're a person who already has clientele and you have people who you know are in the market or looking for homes or for businesses and things like that, then I think it's also a great place and a great way to go. When you ask and you're looking for what the market is like, I think the market will always be great enough for business. I think there will always be enough for you to grow and for you to succeed. I just think you have to have the right mindset when you talk about, just like anything else, just like building up a business. When you talk about real estate, it's kind of in a sense like building up a business. And I think that if you have the proper dedication and the work ethic and the discipline, I believe that you can be great at it, and I think it's still worth it. So I guess earlier I said, you know, it's 50-50. It depends on who you are. I think that still holds true. But the ultimate answer is yes. I do believe real estate is still the way to go in 2021. It is heavily dependent upon who you are. Don't get me wrong. But I believe if you come in here with the right mindset, the right approach, even if you don't have your license right now at the point of watching this video, I'd encourage you to try it. You know, I think it's a great place to start. I think it's a great thing to get involved with. And I think it can be very, very beneficial, very, very lucrative. I just don't want you to go into it with the wrong reasons and the wrong intentions. Hoping and expecting and looking and for things to be one way. And then they'll say if they don't pan out that way, then you're disappointed. Do your research. Have enough knowledge available that you know exactly what you're doing, what you're getting yourself into. That way you don't put yourself in a bad position. Just like anything else in life, you're going to take wins, you're going to take losses. We know all about that in the trenches. I know all about that. I tell you, take wins, you're definitely going to take losses. What I will say is this: real estate market is going to be a perfect career choice. It's still going to be a great path for anybody who is a shark. If you have that dog mentality, if you are a person who's passionate about it and you're in it for the right reasons, if you're in it because you're passionate about it and it's something you genuinely and truly want to be great at, I really believe that this is a great path. And I don't ever believe real estate will ever completely go out of style. But if you're in it for the wrong reasons, such as just to get rich or just trying to get a quick money play, a money grab, then I don't think it's going to be for you. Because you have to understand the challenges moving forward in the real estate business is going to be a lot different than maybe what some people had to deal with in the past due to the pandemic and our ever-changing world. I believe that we live in a world that's completely changed. I believe it's changed forever. I believe that this is our new normal and we have to get used to it. And the market is what it is and it's going to continue to be this way probably forever. So I think that it's a great place to be. I think it can be extremely beneficial for the right person. It just also depends on who you are as a person and what are you looking for and what do you want to do. That wraps up today's video, man. You know what I'm saying? Today I want to do something a little different. We want to talk about the real estate market. We don't really talk about that too much over here, so I want to just give it a go, talk about it, what I've seen, some of the trends I've seen, things going up and going down, and just give a lot of facts about it. You feel me? In the hood, in the trenches, a lot of people are trying to tell you start getting money, oh, you need to invest in real estate, you need to go buy homes, you need to go buy property, you need to go do this, you need to go do that. I hate that mentality, because it's like, bro, you don't understand anything about the real estate market at all. You feel me? So how are you going to tell me what I should or shouldn't do? It's one of those things you have to just do a lot of research. And I've talked about this before in my video. Don't take my word for it. Don't take everything I say at face value. I'm not a financial advisor. I'm not a banker. I'm not an accountant. I did not go to school to get any finance degrees or whatever. I'm simply somebody sharing you through experiences and knowledge that I've gained, and I'm trying to pass it on and let you do what you want with it. At the end of the day, you're going to have to do your own research. You have to do and figure out what applies to you. And the information that I give out, and if it applies to you, you know, take it in and apply it in your life. And if it means nothing to you, then, you know, disregard it. You know what I'm saying? I appreciate you for clicking on the video. Now, if you made it to this point in the video, do me a favor. Drop the gorilla emoji down. I don't care if you commented 100 times. Drop the gorilla emoji down below and let me know you made it to this point in the video. And while you're at it, please hit that subscribe button if you already haven't, as well as hitting that notification bell. That way you're notified anytime I drop some content, as well as leaving a like down below, because it helps the algorithm, helps my channel continue to grow, and helps more and more people find the content and information I'm trying to put out. And before we go, I need y'all to do me a favor. Follow me on social medias. Follow me on my Twitter, follow me on my Instagram, and follow my Snapchat. That way you can stay up to date in the loop with everything I got going on. We're going to continue to push out content. We're continue to do as much as we can. And I thank y'all as much as ever, because we're continuing to grow. We're not growing extremely fast, but we're growing, and I thank y'all for it. So I ask y'all to continue to like the videos. Please continue to subscribe. Please continue to show me love. Continue to post on the stories. I'm going to continue to repost y'all. You know what I'm saying? We headed for the top. You know what I'm saying? I love those who love me. I thank y'all for y'all love and support, man. I'm going to catch y'all back at the next video.